Good morning, everybody. I'd like to welcome you all to Oasis. If you can all go ahead and please make your way to your seats. I'm looking forward to seeing everybody. Well, I'm seeing everybody, so that's already awesome. If you all can go ahead and please stand, we'll go ahead and just begin praising our Lord and singing to the Lord. And like I've said in the past, did you guys come worshiping today? Because worship is so much more than music. It's what you do, it's your lifestyle, it's who you are with other people. So this is our form of worship with music this morning. So just come to the Lord, just praise Him, and continue to worship Him throughout the week, not just on Sundays. So let's go ahead and worship. Let's praise God.
Because you called my name, I'm waking up to sing. And so if you're in this room this morning, He's called your name, He wants your heart, He's ready for you. And so with this next song, let's sing this out to Him as a prayer that He continue to just build this church, continue to build His kingdom, not only in this church, but in our city, and use us as the vessels for that.
Holy Spirit, come and make
round of applause because we know that he will do those things. Awesome. So we're going to slow it down with this last song for the sermon. And we just want to come and ask the Lord, even today, even if we know him today, to just come and awake our hearts, awake our souls, to hear what he wants to speak to us, and for his Holy Spirit to just come and fill this place this morning. So let's sing this out to him. Come and fill. Come.
our Heavenly Father, you're so amazing to each and every one of us, God. Thank you for all you do for us, Lord. And truly, we ask that you come fall afresh on us, Lord. Awaken us from our sleep. Awaken our souls. May we be ever so open to you, Father. May we listen to your word, Lord. May we take it all in. May we accept it for what it is, as truth, Lord. May you help us to continue to grow in our relationship with you, Father. And may you give us that special understanding of you that only you can give us, Father. So I thank you for everything. I thank you for those who are here. I pray for those who are still on their way, Father. May you keep them safe, God. So again, I pray, Lord, that you just open our hearts, open our ears, open our minds, Father, to you. Help us to know your truth and know your word and love you with everything we have, and to be obedient to you and have discernment for you, Father. Thank you so much for all of these things, and I pray all of this in your son's amazing and beautiful name. Amen.
I was sick a couple weeks ago. Just outright sick. Just, I mean, didn't want to be alive anymore kind of sick. You know, I'm like, God, heal me or kill me kind of thing. Take me home now. I am ready. I was sick. Felt like I was on my deathbed. And I don't know how many of you have felt like that before, where you're just like, oh my goodness, this is the worst pain I've ever had. This is the worst experience I've ever had. It's just the worst thing that you've ever gone through kind of illness. Now, what's interesting is when people get sick, they either respond one of two ways. They either want the cure that's going to make them better right away. They're like, man, I am sick. I need help. Give me the cure. Or they're going to respond in more of a prideful way and say, you know what? I'm just going to let this ride its course, and I hope it works out for the best. When it comes to our spiritual lives, we're no different. Some people realize that they are spiritually sick, just covered inside and out with sin, this disease called sin. And they say, okay, I need a cure. And they realize that their only cure for their spiritual disease is Jesus Christ. And yet other people, even though they hear the truth, they say, you know what? I don't need that cure. I'm going to ride it out and hope it works out for the best. And so today might be some people in here who are spiritually sick. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to simply present very hopefully, clearly, very simply this cure that is Jesus Christ. Now it's up to you what you're going to do with it. So with that said, like it says up on the screen, take God's one and only written word and turn with me to a very popular verse called John 3:16. Now, if you don't have a Bible and you need a Bible, just raise your hand and Rod will very, very quickly come and give you a Bible. Now, with that said, those Bibles are yours to keep. And maybe it's your first time holding a Bible. If you don't know where John is in the Bible, you could either ask your neighbor, or if you have a little too much pride or you're a little too embarrassed, what I'm going to do today is I'm going to do something that I usually don't do, but I'm going to put every verse I speak from on the screen. So what you can do today, if you don't know where John is, you can just open up your Bible and do that. And just look like you look like you know what you're doing. And just come along with me on the screen. So, give me an amen if you're with me. Amen. That sounds like most people. The rest of you can catch up, or you can just look it on the screen with me. So, John chapter 3, verse 16. In your Bible or up on the screen, and this is what it says. John chapter 3, verse 16. Jesus is speaking. He's having a conversation with Nicodemus, and their conversation is going pretty well, and Jesus starts to give him some more truth. And this is what he says. He says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life." Verse 17 says, "For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already because he has not believed in the name of God's one and only Son." This is the verdict, says Jesus. Light, referring to Jesus, has come into the world, but men love darkness instead of light because their deeds were evil. Verse 20 tells us that everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light for fear that his deeds will be exposed. And the last verse, Jesus speaks up and he says this, "But whoever lives by the truth comes into the light so that it may be seen plainly that what he has been done through God." Amen? Amen. You know, John chapter 3, verse 16 is probably the most famous verse in all of Scripture. I mean, we see it on refrigerator magnets. We see it on bumper stickers. We see it on t-shirts. We see it on sporting events. We see it everywhere. John 3:16 is such a simple verse that even young children can comprehend it, boys and girls, but yet it is so deep that you can never fully fish out the richness of this verse. It has often been called the inexhaustible verse. In fact, John 3:16, many people say, is all the Bible summed up in one verse. Because what is it? For God so loved the world that he sent his one and only son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. That is the gospel message. That is the Bible in one verse. You know, John 3:16 also does something else. John 3:16, if you start to break it down, combats a lot of isms that go against God and go against the Bible. In fact, if you take every two words almost, you will see how it will combat against isms out there that are against God and against the Bible. In fact, look with me. It's up on the screen, and you can just go pretty much every two words. Starting off, it says, "For God, which combats atheism, which says there is no God. So loved, which combats fatalism, which says that God is an impersonal being," which we know he's not. He's very personal. It says, "The world, which combats nationalism, which says that God only loves one particular people group." No, he loves everybody. "That he gave," which combats materialism, which says that it is more important to receive than it is to give. "His one and only son," which combats against Mohammedism, which states that God did not have a son. Not true. "That whoever," combats against five-point Calvinism, which states that Christ only died for a few. "Believes in him," which combats pluralism, which says that all religions are equally the same. Again, not true. "Shall not perish," which combats against annihilism, which says that there is no hell. Not true. Bible makes that very clear that there is. "But have eternal life," which combats against Arminianism, which states that one can lose their relationship with Christ. John 3:16 has so much power in it, and yet it is so applicable for every human heartbeat. Again, come back with me and look at what John 3:16 says. "For God so loved the world." Well, who is the world? Who is the world? We're all the world. Every human heartbeat. Go as far as you can east, go as far as you can west. Anybody you run into, that is the world. Any continent, any country, any state, any city, any town, any village where you see somebody, that is the world. And guess what? Christ loves them. God loves them. Well, how do we know that's true? Because of what this verse goes on to say. It says, "For God so loved the world." Well, how do we know that? That he gave his one and only son. For those of you who are parents or hopefully to be parents, let me ask you this. Would you sacrifice, would you give up, would you allow your child to be killed for people that you've never even met? I'd like to sit here and say, oh, I would make the sacrifice, but most likely I wouldn't. But yet God, his one and only son, for us, allowed Jesus to be sacrificed. Why? Because as the verse goes on to explain, it says, "So that whoever believes in him shall not perish." That says go to hell. That's what that means, perish, hell, damnation, depending on your translation. "But have eternal life." Who's the whosoever? Does it say only this certain people if they believe in Jesus? No. It says whosoever, meaning it is open up to everybody. You know, the interesting thing about Christianity is very exclusive. I mean, it is a very exclusive faith. Why? Because there's only one way to heaven, and that's Jesus Christ. But yet at the same time that it is so exclusive, it's also incredibly inclusive, meaning this, that anybody can give their life to Christ. Anybody is allowed to give their life to Christ. It's not just for a certain people. So if you want to get to heaven, gosh, what? It's for you too. But there's only one way to get there, and that's through Jesus Christ and him alone. It's like Jesus just gave us a fork in the road. He said, here's the fork in the road. Either you accept Jesus Christ And you can go and have eternal life in heaven, which is awesome. Or guess what? Its choice is completely up to you. You can reject Jesus and therefore choose to perish. See, God is not one who forces his love upon people. What do you call someone who forces their love? You call him a rapist. God is not a rapist. He does not force his love upon anybody, but yet God, because he loves you, allows you to make the decision. It's totally 100% up to you. But because it's 100% up to you, if you reject Jesus, guess what? The Bible's very clear. This verse is very clear. You will perish. So the choice is completely up to you. In fact, maybe this verse might be interesting for you. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21, it says this, that God made him, referring to Jesus, who had no sin, to be sin for us, so that in him, you mean Jesus, we might become the righteousness of God. Jacqueline, I know this is your favorite verse. I know you love this verse a whole lot. And the Lord put it on my heart because God wants you to understand that when Jesus had no sin, never had sin, never did anything wrong, God still put his wrath on him, a punishment we deserve, but yet Jesus took that punishment for us. Jesus did all the hard work, but Jesus says all you simply have to do to get eternal life, to be in heaven, is to simply accept. It's just that simple. There was a little boy, and he had a sister. Now, his sister was extremely sick. She had a blood disease. Now, the brother and the sister had the exact same blood type, which was very rare. And what's interesting is that the brother, he just 2 years prior overcame this same disease and conquered it, so his blood was stronger. So the doctor came up to little Johnny and he said, Johnny, do you want to give your blood to your sister so that she can live? And Johnny looked at the doctor and he got very nervous. His bottom lip started to tremble. And after a moment's time, he went up to the doctor and he said, for my sister, I'll do it. So they wheeled Johnny into the operating room and they had his sister Mary next to him. And they stuck Johnny with the needle and then they stuck Mary with the needle. And then Johnny would start to see the blood go out the tubing. And if you were to look at Mary, she looked very pale and frail. And if you were to look at Johnny, he looked very healthy and robust. Now, after a moment of time of doing this, Johnny's demeanor started to fade. And he started to look a little pale, a little weak. And then it was at that point that his smile started to fade and he looked back up at the doctor and he said, Doctor, is this where I die now? And it was at that moment that the doctor realized that's why Johnny's lip was trembling. That's why Johnny lost his courage. That's why Johnny was stopped smiling, because in Johnny's mind, he thought, I have to die so that my sister can live. Well, fortunately, Johnny didn't have to die, and Johnny didn't die. And fortunately, his sister Mary got better. But you know, when we come to our spiritual lives, it was Jesus who had to give his blood up for us, and it was Jesus who had to die for us. He had to become sin so that we might have the righteousness of God. Do you notice that word might right there in the third line, that we might become the righteous? Why does it say might? Because it's your choice. I can't force it upon you. I can speak and I can speak and I can all kind of verses and illustrations and all kinds of stuff, but it's up to you whether you choose Jesus Christ or not. Come with me to verse 17, back in the text, and it says this, for God did not send his son, Jesus, into the world to condemn the world, that means to find guilt within it, but to save the world through Jesus. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe in Jesus stands condemned already because he has not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. There's a story I want to share. I don't know if you guys know the guy who invented the radar. His name is Sir Robert Watson Watt. So he invented radar, great invention. And it was interesting because he was driving in Canada one day and he was caught in a radar trap. which is very ironic. In fact, he wrote a poem about it, and the poem goes like this. It says, "Pity Sir Robert Watson Watt, strange target of his radar plot, and thus, with others I could mention, a victim of his own invention." When it comes to our spiritual lives, we too are victims of our own invention. So, well, what are you talking about, Alex? When we sin, we rebel against God. And therefore, there is a penalty, a punishment that must take place. And therefore, because we've rebelled against God of our own choosing, of our own doing, we must pay the price. We become a victim of our own invention, our own sinning. I think if you've been a Christian for a while, I can honestly say this, and you know it applies to you. If you've been a Christian, you would consider yourself a Christian, a mature Christian. Every time you sin knowing full well it's a sin. You know, but for some reason, maybe it just seems more appetizing, you decide I'm gonna sin, even knowing that it is a sin. And some people think, well, when did I sin? Aren't I a good person? Because a lot of people, you ask them, hey, when you get to heaven, how are you gonna get to heaven? You ask them that, how are you gonna get to heaven? And they're like, well, I'm a good person. I do good, I'm okay. Really? Because in the Bible it says this, "For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." Do you know what that term sin means? Sin is an archery term. It means to miss the mark. So these archers would compete, and of course in archery you want to aim for the bullseye, you want to aim for the target. Now if you miss the target, even just a little bit, guess what? You have sinned, you have missed the mark. And so what this thing is saying, what this verse, Romans 3:23 says, that we've all missed the mark. We've all fallen short. Well, Alex, how do you figure that we've all fallen short? You know, when I share my faith and I talk to people about Jesus and I try to share the gospel with them, I ask them a few very simple questions. We get to talking and we try and build a connection, and then I ask them, I take them through the Ten Commandments. I'm like, have you heard of the Ten Commandments? And they're like, well, I don't know, maybe. And I say, okay, let's apply the Ten Commandments to our lives. And I ask them the first question. I say, have you ever lied before? And like, well, yeah, I've lied. We all have. I say, okay, that's one. Have you ever stolen anything before, regardless of value, maybe a 5-cent piece of candy, maybe download something illegally, maybe something bootleg, maybe cheat on a test, you stole answers? They're like, yeah. I'm like, okay, that's two. All right, have you ever blasphemed? Have you ever used the Lord's name in vain? And they're like, yeah, I got mad one time. Okay, that's three. Okay, and then I say, okay, have you ever lusted before at somebody? Like, oh, yeah. I'm like, okay, according to God's standard, in Matthew chapter 5, verse 27, 28, it says this, that if you look lustfully upon a person, that's like committing adultery in the heart. So that's four. Now the fifth one, and it usually doesn't take that long, but the fifth one I ask them, I say, have you ever had hatred for somebody? And they're like, oh my goodness, yes, every time I get on the freeway. I'm like, okay, coworkers, boss, employees, whatever. Right? We get angry at people. We have a hatred for people. It may last for a little bit, but we still have a hatred. Jesus said that if you have a hatred for somebody, that is the same thing as committing murder of the heart. See, it's a heart issue with God. And so already, that's just five of the Ten Commandments that they've broken. Sinned, missed the mark. And so I ask them very straightforward. I say, if I came to your house and I said, hi, my name's Alex. I'm a liar. I'm a thief. I'm a murderer. I'm an adulterer. And I'm a blasphemer. Hey, can I come in your house? Like, heck no, get out of here. And they slammed the door on me. In the same way, why would God allow us into his house being liars, cheaters, thieves, adulterers, murderers of the heart, blasphemers? Why would God let us into his house? He wouldn't. He wouldn't, because we fall short of the standard. See, where God is in heaven, it's perfection. It's perfection. And where God is, sin can't be. You can't have sin in heaven. And so we all fall short and we miss the mark. And sometimes people say, well, I just broke one of the Ten Commandments. And you know where I take them to is I take them to James chapter 2, verse 10. And this is what it says. If you've broken one of the Ten Commandments, you're guilty of breaking them all. That's what it says. If you've broken one of the Ten Commandments, you're guilty of breaking them all. When it says that whosoever keeps the whole law, talking about the Ten Commandments, and yet stumbles at just one point, is guilty of breaking it all. It's like this, if you're hanging by a chain, and just one of those chain links breaks, guess what? You fall, even though it's just one, In the same way, we've all fallen short of the glory of God because of our sin. That's the bad news. See, the good news isn't good news unless you share the bad news. Because if you don't share the bad news about our sin and stuff like that, then the good news is just news. So that's the bad news. The good news is this. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this, that while we were sinners, Christ died for us. Do you realize how incredible that is? That while we were living in rebellion to God, that while we were sinning, we were living for ourselves, we were doing our own thing, God says, I don't care, I still love you this much to send my one and only son for you. That's incredible. In fact, in Romans chapter 6, verse 23, it says this, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is Jesus Christ and eternal life. What that's saying is, it's saying this, if you were to receive a paycheck for all of your sin, the paycheck is this, death, which in this context, the Bible means hell. But the good thing is, for those who accept Jesus Christ, guess what? You don't have to go to hell. There is a gift awaiting you if you simply just receive it. And like it says up on the screen, the gift, a free gift, free. The gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Why do you think that the Bible says it's a gift? Because just like on your birthday, just on the holidays, just like it's going to be at Christmas, you have the choice to either accept or reject the gift. You can either accept that gift and say, I want Jesus Christ, or you have the freedom to reject. Remember, God will not force his love on you, but the choice is 100% yours. People say, okay, well, I've heard this. I want to give my life to Christ. How do I do it? Look at this verse up on the screen. It says this. It says in Romans chapter 10, verse 9 through 10, it says that if you simply confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For it is with your heart that you believe and are justified, and it is with your mouth that you confess and are saved. See, it's not just head knowledge, it's heart knowledge with God. A lot of people know Jesus up here, but they're 14 inches down, they don't know him. Their heart is far from him. And so I tell them they're 14 inches from hell and they don't even know it. See, because this verse tells us that if you simply confess that you're not ashamed, that you're willing to profess that Christ is Lord, and yet believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, guess what? It says you will be saved. Why? Because it's a heart issue with God as well. It's a heart issue. You can lie to me, you can lie to yourself, but we can't lie to God. It's a heart issue with God. In fact, Romans chapter 10, verse 13 says this, for everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. A lot of people say, well, you know, maybe it's not Jesus. Maybe it's the Pope. Maybe it's the President. Maybe it's Muhammad. Maybe it's Gandhi. Maybe it's my dad, my mom. You know, my grandpa was a preacher. You know, I should be okay. You know, my wife goes to church or my kids didn't know. When you stand before God, there's no other name that gets you into heaven but Jesus Christ alone. In fact, in Acts chapter 4, verse 12, look at what it says. It says, salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to men by which we must be saved. Do you realize that? In order to get to heaven, there's only one name, only one ticket, only one key that gets you into heaven, and that is Jesus Christ and him alone. How sad it's going to be on that day when people stand before God and they put all their weight and all their eggs in a different basket and they said, oh, well, I thought this and I thought, and God said, no. Jesus Christ and him alone. In fact, because you're at church today, you're going to be held to a higher standard because I am preaching the truth to you. You can't say you were ignorant because God will point to this day and say, that's when you heard the truth. In fact, a lot of people think, well, I can do it on my own. I can earn my way into heaven. If you could earn your way into heaven through works, if you could do anything other than give your life to Christ to get into heaven, then why in the world did Jesus send, or did God send his one and only son to die? If there was any other way into heaven but through Jesus, Jesus wouldn't have had to go to the cross. Do you realize that? In fact, look at this verse up on the screen. It says this in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 and 9, it says, for it is by grace that you have been saved through faith, and this is not from yourselves. It is the gift of God, so that not by works, so that no one can boast. What's that saying? It's saying, when we get into heaven, no one can be up in heaven saying, I got here on my own. I did it. No. We all have to humble ourselves enough to say, I had to give my life to Christ. It was through Christ that we get to heaven. See, Jesus came on a rescue mission. Do you realize that? Jesus came on a rescue mission where he knew fully he'd have to pay the price to rescue all of those who want that free gift. But see, so many people think, okay, I just want to give my life to Christ so that I can just get this heaven and then I'll be okay. I'll get this eternal security. I'll get this fire insurance from hell and I'm going to be okay. No, no, no. See, one of the things I tell people about giving their life to Christ is that it's so much more. There's so much more. Yes, there's heaven, but then there's also life here on earth that can be lived for the fullest, that can be lived for Christ. In fact, look at this up on the screen. It says that the thief comes only to steal, kill, and destroy, but I have come, Jesus says, that they may have life and have it to the full. We like it when our buffet plates are to the full, don't we? We like it when our Thanksgiving and our Christmas plates are to the full. In the same way, Jesus says, I will give you life and I will give it to you to the full. Well, I don't know how many of you are football fans, but for those of you who are, we enjoy the Super Bowl, don't we? We look forward to the Super Bowl. We just are in awe and thrilled by those who are Super Bowl champions. We're like, man, that is awesome, especially if it's your team, then you're going crazy. But you know, when you win the Super Bowl, not only do you get the trophy, which is the main prize, but you get a lot of perks that come with it. You get notoriety, you get fame, you get all these gifts, you get a Super Bowl ring. And yet you also get your name written in the books of history that on this day with this team, you were there. And that's awesome. But you know, in the same way with Christ in our spiritual lives, for those who give their life to Christ, not only are you going to get the trophy, which is heaven, but you also get so much that comes along with it. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, faithfulness, self-control, as Galatians 5 tells us. But yet, when you give your life to Christ, you also get your name written in the book of life, which is so important, so incredibly important. In fact, you're like, what is the book of life? Revelation chapter 20, verse 15 says, if anyone's name was not found written in the book of life, he was thrown into the lake of fire. And so what that paints for us is it says this, that when you stand before God, for those of you who accept Jesus Christ, you're going to be like, oh, praise God. Mitsu, found your name. Woo, huh? You're like, thank God, okay. We're going to be excited to have our names written in the book of life. But how sad is it going to be when you stand before God for those who reject Jesus and God's just going to look through his book and, what was your name? How do you spell that? Okay. Oh, man, what's your middle name? Maybe I'm making a mistake. But how scary that's going to be if your name's not found written in the book of life. Well, how do I get my name written in the book of life? You simply accept this free gift that is Jesus Christ. We're going to talk about how to do that in a minute. Come with me back to the text, and it says this in verse 19 and 20. This is the verdict. Just like you hear verdict in the courtroom, the decision, the final outcome. Light, referring to Jesus, has come into the world, but men loved darkness, referring to sin, instead of Jesus because their deeds were evil. Everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light for fear that his deeds will be exposed. Listen, God already knows what you did. You don't have to be ashamed. God already knows. You simply have to confess and say, you know what? Jesus, I'm wrong. You're right. You have to realize, man, my sins are a stink to God's nostrils. So many people will say, you know, I don't want to meet Jesus because of all the things I've done wrong. God already knows. He's just waiting for you to confess it. That's what he's waiting for. It's interesting that Jesus uses the word verdict. Let's imagine right now a courtroom scene. Imagine if you got robbed and they took a lot of your valuables. In fact, they beat you up. They beat your family members up as they robbed you. And yet a few days later, the cops found them. And a few days after that, they were in court standing before a judge. And you knew about this and you went to the courtroom. Why? Because you want justice. Now imagine if the judge saw all the crimes against this person, how they robbed you, how they inflicted bodily harm, assaulted you. And yet the judge finally says, do you have anything to say for yourself? And the person who robbed you says, well, judge, I'm sorry. I'm a good person. I just made a mistake. I really am. I'll do better next time. And imagine if the judge said, you are a good person. Okay, you know what? Hey, you're free to go. Case dismissed. You'd be furiated. You'd be mad because you want justice. You would call for a good, honest judge. In the same way, when we stand before God, God is a good, honest judge. And he's going to take a look at you, and he's going to look at your rap sheet, and he's going to be like, you've sinned, you lied, you did this. You know, hey, I'm seeing the good you did, but I also see the sin you did. Man, you know, based on this evidence, you're guilty of being in rebellion towards God. And for those who don't accept Jesus Christ and that free gift that is him, guess what? You have nothing to say. You have nothing to say. Even if you say, oh, it wasn't me, I think God could probably roll some kind of film out and come back to us and say, that's not you. That's you. And what are we going to say? We're going to stand before God and have nothing to say. Now, here's the cool thing about Jesus. For those who give their life to Jesus Christ, when you stand before God and you're guilty because of all the sins you've done, and God rolls the tape and you're just like, I got nothing to say, and you're guilty, and God says, hey, based on this evidence, you have to go to hell. Not because I'm sending you there, but because you sent yourself there, because you decided to sin against me. For those who accept Jesus Christ, at that moment, Jesus is going to come into the courtroom and he's going to say, hey, God, you're right. Alex, he lied, he cheated, he lusted in his heart, he murdered in his heart, he blasphemed, he dishonored his parents. He did all these things against you, God. You're right. But while Alex was on earth, he also gave his life to me. And because of that, I took the punishment that he deserves. And it's at that moment that I get to go to heaven. And the same for you who've given your life to Christ. But for those of you in here who know that you have not given your life to Christ, or you're just like, man, I don't know what's going to happen to me when I die. I don't know if I'm going to go to heaven or hell. Let today be the day that you make the best choice you could ever make and give your life to Christ. You say, well, Alex, that's just a silly illustration. Really? Because in my Bible, it says this in Hebrews chapter 9, verse 27, right up here on the screen, it says, just as a man is destined to die once, because you know you're all going to die, right? We're all going to die. We all die. It says, and after that, to face judgment. Well, whose judgment? God's judgment. You know what that verse says? That verse says there's no purgatory, there's no reincarnation, there's no second chances. That it's a one and done here on earth. And then after that, as it says, we're called to face judgment. Are you going to have Jesus represent you when it comes time to be judged? Or are you just going to stand there on your own, hoping for the best, but knowing that you never gave your life to Christ and knowing that it's only the worst? Some people say, well, Alex, Jesus has been talking for 2,000 years. You Christians have been saying that Jesus is coming back for 2,000 years. Yeah, we've been saying that. And we might say it for another 2,000 years. Look at this verse up on the screen. It says this. In 2 Peter 3:9, the Bible addresses that, and it says, the Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some understand slowness, but that he is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. Do you think that maybe the reason Jesus hasn't come back yet is because Jesus is waiting on you? Just hoping? Just desiring that today will be the day? See, because even Jesus doesn't know when he's going to come back. Only God knows. So every day, Jesus is just hoping, oh, please accept me. Please accept me today. Maybe the reason Jesus hasn't come back yet is because he's waiting on you. He's just hoping and desiring that you will make the best choice you could ever make. You remember when we were kids and you would hear the ice cream truck coming? And you'd go run to your parent or piggy bank and you'd go get that money. And what would you do? You'd just wait outside the window looking. You hear the noise. You hear the noise. You're like, oh my gosh, what's going on? I've been waiting here 5 minutes. And yet you still hear the noise. Especially if you're in a neighborhood with a lot of streets. And you could be standing out there for 20, 30 minutes just waiting. Getting baked, getting a tan. Waiting. Until finally, you're like, yeah, the ice cream truck. And even then, it can't get to your house fast enough, so you start running at it. How sad would it be if you finally get to the ice cream truck and you're so excited, and you open your hand and you point and say, I want that. And he looks at the change in your hand, he's like, euros, pesos, pounds. He's like, I don't take that stuff. I take American dollars. It's horrible. You have the wrong currency. But in the same way, man, when Jesus comes, how many of us are holding the wrong spiritual currency? We hold on to everything else except Jesus. And God's going to look at our hand and be like, man, I don't see Jesus in there. You have the wrong spiritual currency. It's going to be a frightening day because we realize there is no second chance. Come with me to verse 21, and it says this. It says, but whoever lives by the truth comes into the light so that it may be seen plainly that what he has been done through God. I don't know your situation. Only you know your situation, really. Some of you are spiritually sick, and today you've realized there's a cure called Jesus. And my question is, will you accept the free cure that is Jesus Christ? Some of you, if you were to die today, you'd stand before God in that courtroom, like I said in that illustration. And I wonder what the verdict would be. For those who reject Jesus Christ and don't want him to represent them, don't want Jesus to be their lawyer, good luck. Because I've already clearly, simply, through God's word, explained how it's going to happen. You know that Jesus is the doctor in the sick room, right? You know that Jesus is the lawyer in the courtroom. And my question is, who's going to take advantage? Who's going to take advantage? The saddest thing, if I get to heaven and I ask about you and you're not there. I know that the Bible says that God will wipe away every tear. I think those are some of the tears he's going to wipe away. But how awesome is it going to be when we get to heaven and we see each other again? Because on this day, at this moment, you decide, I'm going to make the most important decision of my life. I'm going to get that spiritual cure. I am going to allow Jesus to represent me on that day of judgment because of what you did today. You know, the number one thing that keeps people out of heaven is this: pride. It's the number one thing. Say, no, I can get there on my own. Really? I showed you couldn't. Oh, no, I do enough good things. Really? Were you not paying attention when I talked about sin and how we all did it? See, so many people look at God and they say, okay, they look at their life and like, well, I'm good enough. Well, how good is good enough? Well, I'm 51%. How do you know you're 51% sure? Because when we look at God and his word, it's an all or nothing thing. For those in here who know that they're lost, I mean, they just don't have a relationship with Christ. I'm talking to you, but I'm also talking to the people in here who just don't know. They think, maybe I am. They're unsure. Guys, don't die unsure. Let's solidify the decision towards Christ in your heart today. Let me say it this way. For God so loved you that he gave his one and only son, that if you believe in him, you will not perish and go to hell, but you will have everlasting life in heaven. I'm done. The decision is 100% yours. When I stand before God, I don't have to explain, and I don't have to be held accountable for not preaching to you guys the gospel truth, because you've heard the gospel today. Music team, I'm going to ask you to come up. You come up and you bless us again, because you guys are doing awesome at it. For those of you who I asked to be prayer team, if you guys would go to the back. Jacqueline, Rod, if you guys can be a prayer team too. Georgette and Lloyd, if you guys can go. You may be sitting here and you're like, man, I want to give my life to Christ. I need this. This is how you do it. I'm going to explain it, but the prayer teams are going to help walk alongside you. They're not going to do it for you. They're going to walk alongside you. This is how you give your life to Christ. It's four simple steps, but then after that, there's one more. You simply confess your sins. The lying, the cheating, the lust, the hatred, blaspheming God's name. You confess all the sins and you say, God, simply you need to humble yourself and say, God, this is where I'm wrong and you're right. God, these are the things that I've done wrong. That's confession. And then the Bible says that if you will do that, ask God for forgiveness. And the Bible says that when you do that, God will be just to forgive you. So you got to confess your sin. God, I'm wrong, you're right. Humble yourself. Then ask God for forgiveness. The third step is this, that you need to turn away, U-turn, repent. Do a 180 away from all those things that are in rebellion to God. The Bible says, turn away from that. Well, if I turn away from that, what do I turn to? That's the fourth thing. You turn to Jesus Christ and Him alone. And you put your faith and belief in Him. Believe that He is who He said He is, that He did what He said He'll do. Or He did what He said He's done, and that what He says He will do. Because God is coming back one day. Jesus is coming back. Don't play spiritual Russian roulette with your life anymore. Let's solidify today that today is the day you give your life to Christ. And then the additional step after that is to live a life for Him. Live for Christ, because as I said, Jesus came to give life and give it to the full. And you can be a part of that. Now, if you're in here today and you just know, I mean, you just know. In fact, let's do this. Just everyone bow their head, close their eyes. I didn't think I was going to do this, but the Lord's put in my heart to do it. Just everyone just simply bow your heads, close your eyes. That way no one else sees what I'm about to do. But if you're in here today and you want to give your life to Christ, I mean, you just know that if you were to die today, you wouldn't make it to heaven, but you're going to hell. If that's you, will you simply just raise your hand? No one can see, no one can look, no one can watch. Okay, I see you, sir. I see you. You can lower your hand. Is there anybody else? Okay, I see you guys. I see you guys. That's three already. We got three people in the back, three prayer teams. Here's what's going to happen. On the count of three, I'm going to ask that you be pretty bold. I'm going to ask that you be very bold, because as Christians, we're called to be bold. It takes boldness to give your life to Christ. Here's what I'm going to ask. Is there anybody else who just, man, maybe you're confused. Maybe you're like, okay, I thought I gave my life to Christ, but man, I'm just so scared. I just want to make sure. I just need to know. Is that anybody in here? Here's what we're going to do. For those of you who raised your hand, and I saw you, and you can hear my voice and all that, I'm going to ask that you be bold right now. Don't let your pride get in the way. There's at least three of you, and there's three prayer teams back there. Look at how God worked that out, just for you. For those of you who raised your hand, here's what I'm going to ask. On the count of three, I'm going to ask you to do something bold, and I'm going to ask you to just stand up. And then I'm going to ask you to go to those prayer teams. And don't worry, everyone's going to keep their heads down. They're going to keep their eyes bowed. Don't worry about that. But on the count of three, I'm going to ask that you get up and that you go to the back. Don't let your pride get in the way. These teams are ready. They're prepped. We've been praying for you. Let today be the day. So on the count of three, I'm going to ask that you get up and that you go to one of those prayer teams. All right, one. All right, it's going to take boldness. You're going to do it. I'm rooting for you. I've been praying for you all week. Two. All right, be bold. Be bold. This is your time. We're here for you. God's been working on your heart. Go ahead and answer the call. Three. Go ahead, guys. Just rise up. Go ahead. Just stand and go to those prayer teams. Stand and go to those prayer teams. Amen. Amen. You keep going. Keep going. They are there for you. Now, for the rest of us who are sitting here, you can go ahead and look at me. You can lift your head up. Maybe you're sitting here and you're thinking, oh, that message didn't apply to me. Actually, it applies to you very well. Because there are people in your life who need to hear that gospel message, who need to hear about sin and how it's in rebellion to God. Take that message. Maybe you're like, oh, I forgot to write down the scripture. Go to our website. It's on the bulletin. This message will be up there later tonight. Share it with people. Let them know. Even take some of these verses and say, hey, man, the Lord put this on my heart for you. If God does that. My thought is, how many of you know people that need to hear this message? We all need to hear it. I need to repeat it to myself often. Not because I'm not saved, but because I need to remember that it's the gospel that wins people to Christ. So with that said, if you need prayer for anything, when those prayer teams are open, go get them. You need prayer for a lost friend. You need prayer for yourself. You need prayer for your spouse, your kids. You need financial prayer. You need prayer to be bolder in your faith. Whatever it is, let today be the day. Let today be the day you take advantage. With that said, music team, bless us.
All right, I'm going to ask everyone to stand. And we're going to sing this song together. One of the lines in this song says, if grace is an ocean, we're all sinking. How true is that? I mean, no one in this room can say that we deserve God's love, but he gives it so freely. And I'm sorry, I'm really emotional right now, because do you guys realize that when just one person gives their life to Christ, all of heaven rejoices? And for the three who've been bold and went to the back, God's love is just so amazing. So I'm going to try to sing this song, but you guys sing it with me. I know everyone knows the song. So let's sing it out together.
Just how beautiful you are now. Great.
all sing it together, voices only.
Yeah, he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves.
One more time, how he loves us.
Yeah, he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves.
Amen. All right, I'm going to ask everyone to be seated, and we have one more song for you. But this one is just a sit and enjoy and listen song. So, you know, there's many of us in this room who we did say that, yes, we know that we are saved. We know that we're going to heaven. And now for those three who went back and received prayer, we all in this room now can say that we know where we're going. But, you know, this song that we're going to sing still applies to us, because I think even as believers, we just sometimes, you know, we sin. It happens. We're human. And we think that, you know, oh, I don't want to come to God. I can't even come to God with forgiveness or to ask for forgiveness because I'm just so ashamed of what I've done. And the message of this song is that God, you know, as Alex said over and over again, God sees us. He knows our sin. He probably even knows he does. He knows we're going to commit it before we even do. And just the message of this song is that we don't have to be afraid to come to God with our brokenness. He asks us, just come as you are and let me do the work in you. Let me clean you up. And so just enjoy this song.
Come out of sadness from wherever you've been. Come broken heart. Let a rescue begin. Come find your mercy. Oh, sinner, come near. 'Cause earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. And earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal.
So lay down your burden.
Come sit at the table, come taste the grace. There's rest for the weary, rest that endures. And earth has no sorrow that heaven can't cure.
So lay down your burdens, lay down your shame.
No sorrow that heaven can't heal. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal.
So lay down your burdens, lay down your shame. All who are broken, lift up your face. O wanderer, come home, you're not too far. So lay down your hurt, lay down your heart, come as you are.
Thank you, Lord. We praise you, God, for what you've done here today, God. We praise you for loving us so much, God. We praise you that everyone in this room has tasted your grace and your love, and that we all know and are assured, God, that we will be together with you in heaven one day, God, and just how amazing that is, Lord. So we thank you, and we ask, God, that you help us, Lord, to take this gospel message out into the world, God, to take it to those who don't know you, and to bring just that free gift to them, God, that you've so freely given, Lord. And we just thank you for that sacrifice that you made. Thank you for loving us so much. And we pray this all in Jesus' name.